Welcome back to Q&A. All right, let's bring the panel in now. We've been talking about this interview, this idea of the exhausted middle, the extremes. John Tamihere, do you buy this idea that there is hope that if we look at the exhausted middle and that politicians, if they start trying to focus back to the middle, that we can avoid this sort of polarisation?
Yeah, I think there's always hope. The problem I've got is that the two experts that you had on, it's a good discussion, but really, they really have to start to look at the failure of the economic and political, therefore political debate that we've had over the last 35 years. And if it's that failure, well then...
You're talking about market economics?
I'm talking about supply-side economics or trickle-down economics. And so if it's an emperor without any clothes anymore, you've really got to speak that out and say it, rather than look at identity politics, rather than look at a left and right narrative. The final thing I'd say is that I think a left and right narrative is very lazy these days. I think that went down with the Berlin Wall in 1984.
I think
we've got a widening debate.
What research is showing is that exhausted middle, as they say, is far from lukewarm. It's quite radical on economic change, on redistribution. So it wants to see something done about the concentration of wealth. And this is what I think is so interesting. So you've got a rise of polarisation rather than the populism. So you've got these two fringes, which are really a white civil war. Between the, I heard one commentator call it between the haves and the have-yots. You know, you've got that the social liberals, the urban liberals on the one side, and then the sort of wealthy conservatives on the other side. So in the middle are most voters who don't want to see the kind of fractured nastiness in politics, and they do want to see something done about inequality.
But you're right, John. We're vulnerable here, aren't we? Because New Zealand has not had a recession, Fran, for 10 years. Mm. And if we were to have a recession, those extremes might get more traction here.
Yes, I think they probably will. And what's really also interesting is, globalisation itself is under threat. The whole mantra about the world being flat, about multiculturalism, and what we're actually seeing is the rise of tribalism again all over the place. And we've been quite extraordinary here, but I think if you kind of peel it back and you get around the country, there would be a lot of people get in the South Island and that who actually regret where we've gone to. They haven't embraced multiculturalism. They've looked at Auckland becoming, primarily a lot of the drivers are from offshore. New Zealanders, old New Zealanders, can't afford, to be there. And that's kind of a bit of a sense. We've priced ourselves out. So I think there's a lot of stuff that hasn't really, kind of come to the surface, but would in a recession.
There's an interesting statistic in that research, which is that 80% of voters are worried that, this is their words, political correctness has gone too far, but then 80% hate are really worried about hate speech. So that tells you that if you're trying to, most people are actually socially liberal now, they support gay marriage, they go,
but they don't want to hear it all the time.
But they don't want to hear it all the time.
No, they don't want to hear
it. And they don't want you to have special
treatment.
And they
don't want to feel you're you might be transgender and you're defined by that. And I took from what was said before, you're kind of the person in the round and sexuality is just one part of it. But I think what we're doing through the whole mantra of bringing your whole self to work and all of that is people are actually being defined by their sexuality, not by their whole person. And I think that's a shame.
John Tamihere, you could end up being a politician again if you run for mayor of Auckland.
Yes, John, would you like to announce?
Anything's possible.
It's possible. You want to share us information on this?
We'll cross that bridge very shortly.
Oh my gosh, he's a politician already.
I think the point that this has all raised is there is a significant rising dissatisfaction. Rising disenchantment, and it's been captured on the polarizations of this. But someone's going to come along and capture the middle pretty soon, because the debate around hope and the relevance of the alleviation of poverty and all that, I think Jacinda's on the right track in that regard and on the right side of the debate and where that's heading. So it's going to be very interesting to see.
But could there be an environment for Judith Collins type politician that is perhaps a harder edge? That could there come a time where she may be able to get, be the person that people look to?
Well, I mean, I think, who knows what kind of politician Judith Collins would be. I think she's got that hardcore crusher Tory brand built in. So all she has to do is come in as a new leader, hypothetically, and be a little bit compassionate and a little bit nice, and everyone will go, oh, she's all right. But I think, to your point, that talk about identity politics and universalism. So John McTurnan picked it up there, and I think it comes back to what I think Labor need to do here, is that those big universal themes are actually the opposite of identity politics by definition.
Right.
So that if you're making a big case for something that's to do with inequality, or it might be, you know, in the past it's been pensions, it's been, state housing, then you get, you capture people's excitement.
That's interesting because this government, Labor, has resisted the urge for closing the gaps for targeted policies, haven't they?
Yes,
and that must
have.
Be a conscious decision, do you think?
Well, I think their problem is they've actually got to take the middle ground with them. And, you know, as you said before, I mean, the jury's out on when the next recession is. I think we're now in very cautious times. A lot of companies are de-risking, and they're de-risking, one, that these things do come down. You know, everything's got a bit overcooked internationally on asset values. But also some concern about what comes out of the United States, you know, with the midterms. If we do see a change, you know, the Dems pick up the Congress, that could mean quite a bit of difference. You know, trade deals won't necessarily get signed off, and a lot of President Trump's agenda, be it from the point of view of doing more on federal taxation cuts, all of that, I mean, that all can get arrested. And also, you know,
it
stop the budget going through.
Have to leave it there, unfortunately, but thank you very much to the panel.